All right, so this is week 8, and we are doing the second part of hydronic system components. So we did size the radiators, we did size the piping, we sized the pump last week. This week we'll size the expansion tank. This is the expansion tank. Any hydraulic system should have an expansion tank. The main purpose of the expansion tank is to contain the expansion of water. Water expands. Maybe you don't see it, but it does expand a little bit. When we accumulate all the amount of water in the house and we heat it up, it will expand. If there's no room for expansion, it will leak. Unlike air, water does not compress or expand. It does not compress, but it does expand. When we mean by compress, it changes in size, but it cannot compress water. It will remain the same volume at the same temperature. The only thing that make water expand or contract is temperature. However, you can get a cylinder of air and push against it, right? So you're compressing it. You cannot do that with water. For shocks, some cars have shocks filled with air, right? Air suspension. So you are compressing air, that's why it's smoother. Usually high-end cars have air suspension. And you keep pumping air in and out, maybe higher and lower, because air that expands is softer, giving you the cushioning. However, it's more expensive. If you buy, I remember in the 90s with the Lincoln and the Cadillac, they have kind of balloons instead of suspension,
bags.
And you pump them up and you can deflate them, and you can hear it sometimes go up and down based on the highway, make it soft, make it hard. It's very involved. However, for the other regular cars, what do you have? What's in the shocks?
Gas.
Oil. Some of them have gas. Gas one do not last as long.
Need those bags.
Bags are expensive. Yeah. So usually when the car gets old, people do a conversion kit and go back to demote the car. So this is something you have to think about. Expansion and contraction, and you want the system to act smoothly without any leaks. If you have oil shocks and you go fast over a pump, what will happen? It will explode because you compressed it too fast, too hard. It just the seal will go out, and you have oil, and you can tell that your shocks are bad because they're leaking oil. So you know the shocks are bad. So basically, we just provide cushion for the water to be able to expand comfortably when it's heated. As you see, the expansion of water in the entire house is not that much, but again, it's enough to leak. And once you push against a weak spot and you cause a leak, it's not going to stop. You already made an opening, so you have to go and find the leak. So
half of leak resistance.
This is,
half of leak resistance.
Yeah. So eventually it will leak, but so you want to have an expansion tank. Some places do not have expansion tanks, and that's the wrong procedure. You should must have an expansion tank. It's how it hangs in the flow, in the ladder flow, and there is an air separator that takes the air out of the system and vent it out. The water comes in this side over here. So it pushes against the diaphragm and gives it more flexibility. You see this compartment here is full of air because once it contracts, what's gonna fill it? You want vacuum. If you have vacuum, it's gonna push against the diaphragm. So you want this to be open so you have up and down movement freely with air coming in and out. And this looks like a trailer valve. Opens up and down.
Now, do all expansion tanks have bladders? All expansion tanks have bladders?
Good question. No. But this is the most common one for residential. There is something called air cushion expansion tank, which basically just a tank that is closed and has air. The problem with having no separation between the air and water, what do you think the problem is?
The hammer? Noise.
No. What else?
Water.
Yeah. If you don't have this separation bladder.
Water. Air in the water.
Air in the water. So when water is cold, the solubility of air into the water is higher, so you're gonna have a lot of dissolved air in the water. When it heats, it will let go of these bubbles, and that's when you have a lot of bubbles in the system. So you're gonna keep always adding water to your system, which you don't want. You want it to be water-free. At the same temperature. So, if any of you ever had like a fish tank, if you don't have that air circulating the water, you will reduce the dissolved amount of water in the of air in the water.
I have a weird one on the cake. You gotta add pellets to it to take the minerals out of it and everything.
Yeah.
But it's a whole, the big, tall blue ones.
But anyway, the idea is that you have to exchange water with air all the time, otherwise it's not going to dissolve. If you think about it, it's very hard for us to imagine that there's water in the air, but there is, otherwise the fish will die. And the amount of oxygen in the water is almost, I think, 15%, which is the same amount of oxygen in the air. So it's really possible to breathe oxygen from the water if you have gills. But you have to have, there's some water in it.
Amniotic fluid, babies drink that, breathe in that.
There you go, Dr. Kellogg. Medical stuff. I didn't even think about it this way. Good thing. Thank you. Good example. Okay, so this is what it looks like. These are the components. This is the fill line. So, and also an insulation line. So you can turn off the valve, take out the tank, and put a new one. If it leaks from here, you know the diaphragm is worn. I mean, eventually this will worn out. It's a piece of rubber. It could leak. It has a good life expectancy in it, but it does leak. So this is the specification for the tank. The fill pressure is 12 psi. Maximum working pressure is 60 psi. Maximum temperature is 240. So these are the specifications that you should not exceed. Fill pressure, we'll talk about that now, and how do we calculate fill pressure. And it's also called charge pressure for the open system. And 60 psi is a lot. What is atmospheric pressure? 14.7 psi. That's atmospheric pressure. So what is vacuum?
Minus 14.7.
No pressure at all. That's vacuum. What is the most common psi pressure for a relief valve?
15.
No.
10?
No.
No, it's
30.
30.
Remember this. This was in the oil burn exam. 30 psi is the relief pressure, relief valve pressure for all residential, 30. If it does not open at 30, that means it's twice the atmosphere. We don't want to do that, so we're gonna vent. And most residential applications are low pressure. Okay, don't be scared, but this is how we going to calculate it. This is all, this equation is in the sheet, you bring it with you. There is nothing more than multiplication and subtracting. Just a little bit involved. We just have to find all these components and just plug them in. I don't want you to memorize this equation. You don't need to to know how does it function. But let's think about it a little bit and how do you find these components. It's very simple, and I give you all that, all the meaning of those. And actually, I put it in a sheet so it will be easy to look at. Look at the sheet here, second part. I give you the equation and I give you the definition for each one of those components. So you know how to find it. So when you get a diaphragm tank, calculation is the first thing you put in the equation and see what information do you have. And all this information are obtainable. You can get them. We'll talk about them one by one. So P fill and P charge. What do you think this talk about? The pressure of fill, the pressure of charge. Perfect, thank you. So what is existing in the system now? If nothing is happening, what is the pressure being acting in the system? Because of the water weight. System is high, right? And water has weight. So intuitively, the water is acting on the system because of the height. We have static pressure, guys. So there is naturally some pressure acting in the system. So this is the natural system. And 5 is a constant. H of the system is the height of the system, because again, the pressure we get is only from the height of the water. The higher the water, the more pressure it exerts, right? We agree on that? It's the height of the system minus the height of the tank. So we're not going to take the height all the way from the top to the bottom. That usually is handling around 5 or 6 feet. So the difference in height between the system and the tank. Make sense? And then the density of the water when it's cold. Why do we need the density? We just want to know the weight of the water. And the 144 is a conversion between feet and inches. So this is gonna be constant. You don't even change that. So the only thing, usually these are given. If it's not given in real life, you're gonna go and measure, see what is the height. And density of the water when it's cold. And I believe I put this in the temperature density table here. So just look it up. So if we look here, we can see the temperature goes from 50 all the way to 280. And what is the density of the water? You're not going to need more than 220. So it does fluctuate and it does make a difference. So where do we get decode? You see it?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Just come straight look up. These are giving, and this is the P fill or the P charge. Make sense?
This is all part of the side of the expansion.
Yes. Question? About the first part only. There are a couple of lone people here. This is very simple math. It's very simple. Any fourth grader?
Any fourth grader?
Yeah, and where are you?
Or what do you think?
I think it's basic math. But it is, it's just how you find P fill, P charge.
That's what you actually find, but it's equation. This is what you get when you solve this equation.
Oh, okay.
Okay? So you got the P fill or P charge. And now we want to find the volume of the tank. So I can find out how many gallons do I need to contain that tank.
Too much math.
Do we really need all this math, or does it usually come right on the side of the tank?
No, actually you need it. Ask Bill about it. I did verify that you need to do the calculation. And a lot of people just ballpark it. If you oversize it, the system is not going to work well. You're going to have a lot of air. If you undersize it, it's going to leak. So you need that. And to make things easier for you, not for the quiz though, for the project, I made an Excel calculator.
Excel?
Yeah.
It's online.
It will, you fill in the blanks and it will give you the size. That's for you, that's my gift. So you don't have to do all this math. But for the quiz, you have to do it. For the project, at least once.
Look at you, got feet on it.
You have to do it. No way around it.
First
okay? This is as complicated as it gets. I promise you. It's not even complicated.
I promised us that last semester.
I know. No, but I it was for that semester. It was for that semester. So volume of the tank. We have to find the volume of the system, which is the water amount in the system. How do we find that? What do you think the water, the volume of the system is equals to? Look at the top here.
Hey, do we get that sheet on the quiz?
You keep it. You had it.
But we can use
yeah,
it.
Of course. Okay. Volume system is the volume in the pipes, how much water in the pipe, how much water in the boiler, how much water in the radiator. It's intuitive. How much water I have in the system. And that will fill into the volume of the system. Okay? Density of the water when it's cold from the table, density of the water when it's hot.
So
what is our quotient?
Is there any machine that can calculate the total volume of the water in the system?
There's a calculator I put in online.
Or you have to calculate the water, and you can't just, there's nothing that you can do.
Yeah, no, you have to calculate the water.
Somebody needs to invent that.
You know what? There's a smart way to do it. What are you going to do? Empty the system and fill it and count and put a
meter on it.
Meter on it. You can work smart. Like, seriously, I can empty the whole system, put a gauge, and fill it up. There's always ways around it.
It's all,
and count.
That's really
good. There are so many ways you can do that. So it's not really that very precise. What is this?
Constant.
Wait, what is it? It is constant, but what does it represent?
Atmosphere of water.
Atmospheric pressure. One over the P fill, which we calculated already, plus the atmospheric pressure. Makes sense because atmospheric pressure is going to be acting everywhere. What is PRV?
Pressure relief.
Pumping volume. Relief valve.
Oh.
Which is what?
30.
Not 30.
30.
We just said it's 30. Always a 30.
It's always 30.
But they put it in the equation because just in case you go to industrial or something very oversized, you might need some code that have something different than 30, but so far I've seen only 30. And then you have all the numbers you need. You do PEMDAS, do the parentheses, do it one by one. My advice for the last 3 years that I've been doing this, people just try to do everything in one shot. And this is how things get messed up. Please try to write the equation, fill in the blanks, do it step by step. Just in case something falls between the cracks, I'll give you partial. If I give you the question, you give me 5 gallons, it's not 5 gallons, I'm not gonna do it. But if you follow the steps and you give me like 4 gallons, I'll give you the number, I don't care. At least you followed the process correctly. When you need to, you can double check it. And I do understand that there's anxiety, but at least you can fill the right numbers.
And I think you made it on the tools, right?
Yeah.
So you have something for density of hot and cold? What's that here?
Yeah, well, see, the temperature changes from 50 all the way to... It took me 6 hours to make. But just to put it all together, so you don't have to go flip pages. The first semester I made an open book, and everybody was flipping pages, wasting time flipping pages. One page. Diaphragm, that's different calculation. That's this air cushion, this diaphragm. What is air cushion? There's no diaphragm in it. Just a big tank with air in it. This is diaphragm. And the other system, same time, same thing. Multiplied by ratio of density, -1. So this is going to be, this number is going to be less than 1. You agree? The density of the water when it's cold is higher than the density of the water when it's hot. You agree? So it's going to be 1 point something. 1 point something minus 1 is going to be something. So 0.0 something. It's going to be less than 1. Here, we have 30, heat charge which we calculated. And multiply that by the volume of the system, and you got your volume of expansion time. Quiz 5 is going to be only about expansion time. I'm going to give you expansion time, you just calculate. Take your time, do the steps, you can get a 10 in it easily. And I'm not going even to nitpick the operation. As long as you fill in the right numbers and you follow the steps, I don't care what you get. At the end, you can put in a calculator and get the numbers. I just want you to understand the steps that goes through it. Let's think about it a little bit visually. This is my expansion tank. This one is supposed to be upside down. So what would be my system height? 0 from the ground to here, the highest point of the water, which is here. It's going to be system height. Tank height is going to be probably here, which is 6 feet. So you only have 4 feet or 5 feet of height difference. And relief valve is going to go in the boiler, 30 psi. The volume of the water is going to be the volume of all the pipes. So we drill the pipe at the same size. So you can get the volume inside the pipes. I think I gave you the equation here, table as well. If you look at the table, in the back, top corner, you see the volume for each size pipe per foot. Just to guesstimate it, for copper and for steel. Half an inch, you multiply for the length, and so on. If you already did the equivalent length method, no, that's different, I'm not
gonna
do that.
Oh.
Let's keep it simple. Simplicity is the key. So let's go back again and look. As any of these variables seems you don't know where to get it from? Height of system, feet from the table, volume of system, you calculate, equation, table, equation, 30. You plug it in, then you just proceed with the calculation. So, order of operation, I put that in the PowerPoint, and that's do the things inside the parentheses first. Exponents, we don't have exponents here. Multiply, multiplication goes first, then division, addition, subtraction. Write that on your sheet of paper if you want. I get confused sometimes, I get overwhelmed. Okay, so this is the calculator. It's on blackboard. So basically, you still have to put in your D cold and D hot, PRV is 30, height of the system, height of the tank, volume of the system that you have to calculate. And basically just does the big, messy equation and give you the numbers. But we'll do the P fill for you to do the volume of the tank, whether it's air cushion or gas. This is still the same. Make sense? So for the project, you can double check your answers using the calculator, so you don't have to do all of that. But you can at least look at the numbers. Excel is a very valuable tool. If you have to do some calculation, even for your own finance, it's really, really helpful. Just put what you spend, what you get, and multiply, and it's really good if you know how to use it. It does all the mathematical functions, and it's convenient. It gets a little bit messy with all the calculations, but with Excel sheet, it still has its own value and make things a little bit more convenient. To reiterate, these are the values. V tank means the minimum tank size in the system, total volume of water in the system, which includes three things. What are those three things? Axel? The volume of water in the system. No, the volume in the pipes, the volume in the radiators, the volume in the boiler. How do we get the volume in the boiler? If it's not labeled, use this equation here. It says volume, water, the boiler BTU per hour, multiplied by 0.186. That's a ballpark number. Again, as Simon said, really, I don't want to do all this measurement. Far enough, fill the entire system with water and empty the meter duct. Put a meter on it. Flow meter and know how much water is there. This is the water at the fill temperature, when it's cold, when it's hot. P fill, we calculate, which is the same as the P charge. This is actually here. The relief valve pressure is 30 psi. Let me fix it.
Nice painting.
Yeah, it's a flat.
Height from the boiler room floor to the high system components. Height from the boiler room floor to the expansion tank water connection, which is the top of the tank and the bottom. It's going to be hanging upside down from the bottom to here. That's going to be your system height. Okay. Any questions so far? This is the table for the water density, which is in your sheet as well. All the way from 50 to 80. You're not going to go to 280. The limit here is 240 maximum temperature, so it's going to be here. And you see the fluctuation in density. The water becomes less dense as we heat it up. It's tend to push against the walls. System calculations: volume of the pipes can get through from the table per foot. Volume of the boiler, if it's not given, we can use the equation for 1,000 BTU. You have 0.186, and volume in the radiators. The volume in the radiators, if it's not given, you can look it up, or just assume a long pipe if it's baseboard radiators. Some radiators have more water because they are convoluted, they go up and down. So you might wanna know how much is the volume in there. Volume in the pipe, this is from your sheet. The size usually is gonna be 3/4. Half an inch, maybe 1 inch. Steel and pipe, they have different gallons. Why do you think, let me see here. Why do you have more volume in the steel 1 inch than steel? And then the copper than steel? This one is less. What is
copper,
this?
Copper's thinner.
It's the nominal. So this is the nominal. It's what the pipe is known for. The actual ID or OD is different. So it depends on the inner diameter or outer diameter. So half an inch pipe, apparently in the steel, it's smaller than the pipe because different nomination for the top diameter. And why is that? The diameter for steel usually is from the outside because of the threading machine. Usually we need to thread steel pipes. So we want the outside to be half an inch no matter what, otherwise the die is just going, not going to get in. So for boilers, usually, I think new boilers, they label the amount of volume is in there. It shouldn't be more than 5 or 6 gallons at a time. Otherwise, it will take forever to heat. It makes it more efficient if you have small boiler. It also depends on the heat exchanger design. If you have a very efficient heat exchanger design, you need to contain a lot of water. That's same with the on-demand heaters. They have very, very efficient heat exchanger, so we do not have to heat a lot of water. Just a small amount is enough. If it's not labeled and you have an old design, you can use this equation again, which goes per BTU. It's better to err on the side of caution than overestimate a little bit, but an accurate volume will be better. So volume of the pipes, volume of the radiators, and volume of the boiler. And this is it. This is how we do calculation for heat exchange deck. I'll do a few examples. As you can tell, as long as you have all the information with you, it's not a very difficult process. Just follow us through for the calculations. Again, a lot of people just ballpark it. And if you go to already installed system, and you can do the same size, at least you did the same size, but don't change the design. If you add an extension to your house or add expansion, probably you added more volume, and probably you need to change the expansion like that. This concludes all the components you need for hydronic system. So for now, you can be 80% done with your project. The only part we haven't done yet is the cooling system. For cooling, I don't want too much. Don't even do the duct. Just tell me how many CFMs you need for each room, and we'll cover that in 2 weeks. Just give me the CFM and how many tons of refrigeration you need for the house. That's it. That's what I need for the cooling. But for the heating, we're done. For the controls, I'm sure we all know about the thermostats. Location of the thermostat is very important. Again, if I look at the thermostat over there, it's going to be really hot in this area, because if the AC is over here, this area is going to heat first on the other side. So always try to strategically place your thermostat to the area where you want temperature to be measured at. That's why it's better always to do more zoning. Aquastat, if you have a hydraulic system, you have to have an aquastat. I'm sure by now you're very familiar with their function. How do they operate? Zone valves or pumps, that's how we're going to do the zones. Again, the selection between zone valves and pumps depends on the loops you have in the house. You can have every loop with different zone valve and a main circulator pump to turn on the water, or you can have 3 zones and each zone has its own pump. Usually if you see like a multi-family house with 1 boiler, you see 2 pumps. So I wanna turn the pump for the entire house because that's a waste of energy. And also, if you turn the pump for the entire house without enough zone valves, you might heat areas that you don't want to. You might see some heat. Another thing I want to bring your attention to is look at the end of the second page. There is something called the heat loss from bare pipes. Why are we talking about this? So some of you in the project are not going to heat the basement, right? It's up to you. But you also don't want the basement to be freezing cold. So you want it to be around 50 at least. I'm not going to heat it, but I want it to be around 50. So sometimes it makes sense to just not insulate the pipes going to the house. So that will be enough heat to just keep the basement at 50. So this is how much heat I'm going to get from bad pipes.
Wouldn't the flame from the boiler radiate a little bit and cause some heat?
No, it shouldn't. No? It shouldn't. If it does, then that's a bad design. So, bare pipes. In some designs, I just leave the pipes there and calculate how much heat it will shoot out, and just keep it for the basement so it would not freeze. And some you will see one radiator for the entire basement, just to. Sometimes they just put fins on the bare pipe just to radiate more heat. So this is how much you can get from the bare pipe without fins, based on the size and temperature difference. By DT, we mean the temperature between the space and the temperature in the water and in the pipe. So this is how much heat loss you'll get per foot. So if you have a temperature difference of, let's say the basement is at 50 and your water is at 180, so that's 120, that's over 100. So I'm going to go over 100. This is the minimum that I'm going to get out of this pipe. If it's 3/4, 64 BTU per foot. So I'm sure you have at least 30 feet of pipes in there. So that's enough heat to keep the basement at least at a reasonable temperature. And usually, you do not insulate the outgoing water. You insulate the coming water. Why? Because you want the priority for the house. First, I'll heat the house. Then, whatever residual heat is there, the water usually come out of the house. Will be water temperature minus at least 20. So if you have water at 180, should be coming back at 160, 150. It loses some heat while it's at it and goes to the boiler to get more heat. So that's another way to do it. If you insulate all the pipes perfectly and there's no heat coming to the basement, you risk freezing some pipes, especially if you're not asking for heat, if you leave the house, heat it off, the boiler breaks down in the middle of the night, it gets super cold, and you freeze a pipe.
You die.
I don't know about that. You freeze the pipe and you have a major leak in the basement, so you don't want to do that. So I use that for your project, and I'm going to ask you this also in probably the quiz 5 or 6. I'll give you a pipe and just tell you, look up how much heat it goes through this. This is how you look it up. This is per foot. So I think we covered most of the equation in here, even though it seems a lot, but it's not. Just a variation of the same equation. Circulators, heat transfer through a wall. Trust me on that, you better have one sheet than to have a whole book and look and browse through it. This is for the, again, flow rate. The equation for the equivalent length. This is the equation we saw today. That's what they mean. So in case you forget what it means, it's here, the definition. Here's where you get the densities, volumes, the degree of the volumes, it's how you calculate the volume in the pipes, volume in the radiator, you can just consider it as pipes, or you can look it up, and this is for the boiler, and bare pipe. So I think this is very sufficient for designing a hydronic system, for now. So you have enough information to at least finish up the project. By this week, I think you should have the heat loss done by now. So we can, at least this week, we can work on it and finish it up. Between four people in the group or three, that will be enough work, yeah.
You said we have to have a boiler, right?
Yeah.
So you can't do anything else?
What,
like hot air?
It has to be for the heat we want, like right now. Because especially in this area, not a lot of people depend solely on forced air. You have to have auxiliary heating system. Sometimes it does not work efficiently. I have not seen a place where they solely depend on hot air. Do you?
Yeah.
Just hot air?
Yeah.
That's what I guess. Yeah. I think around here, the only big place they really have.
The majority of places are hot air.
Boilers, well, oil, that's winter.
We'll do hydronic for heating. And for cooling, we can do forced air as well as supplementary heat. Okay? Primary control, we talked about that, that's the type of control the firing. Eventually, everything will go into heat pump when they're really efficient, but even now, I think you have to have auxiliary heating just in case it malfunctions or it doesn't work correctly. And most thermostats are actually available for both forced air heat and auxiliary heat, just in case. the gas plant. Let's work an example. Where is it? Good enough. For Wednesday, I have six examples. We do the same thing.
Okay.
Let me do one example.
Mm-hmm.
Six examples. Yeah. Well, just like we were doing for the last 8 weeks, everybody will do one as a group, just to make sure we have the process. So we are required to calculate this expansion tank. Let me just see what I have. I'm going to do the first one. So PRV. PSI, T coal in the house is 60. So it's a one-story house with a height of 10 feet. So what is the system height? I'll say around 10. It's one-story, going from the basement to the top. So age of the system, 10 feet. T hot, 180. Piping is 1 inch copper, 200 feet long. And the boiler, I mean, it says here neglect the heating unit volume because probably just the same pipe size going all the way around. So I will say, five, 200 feet, boiler. The information we need. We want to use diaphragm expansion tank. So I have I can give the information for both V system, V coil, V hot, PRV, V charge. V charge you have to calculate. Here's the charge. Five plus.
H system. H tank. Where you get your D cold?
Sorry. Oh, specifically says density. Okay. So it's not the T. So we grab the 60 over there and go to the temperature density table?
Yeah.
You forgot P fill.
No.
P fill?
It's the same thing. It's four.
They're exchangeable.
P fill or?
Oh,
okay.
Okay.
Got it.
Do we have hydro system?
Yes.
We have hydro tank. What is D call? It's going to be from here. So. Hold on.
Yes.
So. What is my temperature here?
60.
60, so what am I looking at?
62.37.
Everybody got that?
It's a homework.
Don't do that.
No, okay.
So 10, we have.
Don't do that.
We have the cold tank, which is right here. 60.
37.
So we go on to the other side of that. It's on the other side of that. And you get
what is
60
hot while I'm at it?
That's its density.
60.57. Yeah. 60.5. Make sense? Raise your hand if it's a little bit confusing.
Why you need to find the hot?
What is your question? No question? What is the confusing part?
The numbers.
The numbers. A lot of numbers. Variables, basically.
Yeah, a lot of variables. So we get the densities.
And you always have to find the density from the hot and the cold.
So we get the density, cold, density, hot. So I'll just, now I have enough information to find my P charge. You agree?
Yeah.
So what do I do? Put in the number. Stay with it. The system is 10. Minus 6 times V cold, 62.37 over 144. And now it's just copy over. So what does it say? First, do the parentheses, right? Don't jump the gun. 5. Plus,
four.
It's going to be 4. This needs to be punched in. You get the P charge. 1.44 is from the equation.
Yeah, 1.76.
The 62.37 he got from the chart because he had the temp and he looked on the chart and saw what the temp was.
I get it.
You know, perhaps you should write it down.
I got a video.
Okay, it's on you. Math requires practice.
Yep.
If you do the 6 questions that I put in the blackboard, two of them, 3 of them, if you feel comfortable, you should be all set.
You put some on blackboard, you said?
Huh?
Put some on blackboard?
Yeah. So now we need to do the diaphragm V tank. So V tank equal, what is V system? We don't know. You gonna find it? V cool. Over
we have all those variables.
See, I only forgot something. Minus 1
times
PR plus 9.7 and PRV minus P charge
minus 5.
Okay. The only thing I don't have in this equation is the V system, so I have to calculate the V system. And what is the V system? The V boiler? It says 50,000, right?
Yep.
So from here I can say V boiler.
Come take a little away.
V5. What is the length? 200? Times, it's copper and it's 1 inch. So 0.043. 4.6.
4.6.
Two. And this was to be ignored. Any question? So V system. 9.3 plus 9.2 equals 18.5 gallons. Alright. So now we have all the information we need for the top equation. I'm gonna put it right here. Everybody's done with this part?
No, you can finish that.
Yeah.
Oh, yo, come on now. You fucking lying. Such a girl, man.
Just stop the video.